as promised, I have Sushant here with me. He is an icon. He is in many ways, but primarily he represents art, that is drag, and I love that work. He's an amazing singer. He's an activist. He's an influencer in Mumbai and in India. And now in the US, we are getting him launched here. We had some other plans, but this is what we plan to do today, is spend a full hour with him, make him sing, and he's going to tell us lots of interesting stories and fashion tips in the end. So stay tuned. So Sushant, welcome to FabLife 360. I'm so glad you could join me today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Seema. It's a pleasure, and namaskar to everyone. It's an absolute pleasure because I've heard so much about you and all good things. So it's absolutely my pleasure, completely my pleasure.
Thank you. That was very sweet of you to say that. So tell me, when did you know that this was your thing? And when did you do your absolutely first something, 5, 6, 10 years old? And how has it been since then?
I used to, first of all, I would like to reiterate and re-articulate what you just said, because drag has no boundaries and art has no boundaries. So because drag is considered a performance art, I would just like to tell people out there that have these preconceived notions or misconstrued fallacies as to the fact that, they completely disregard the fact that art should be just art. And, a lot of times we see people that are like, drag is just for gay men, or drag is just for effeminate gay men, or drag is this, and drag should not be done by women, drag cannot be done by trans people. And I think that these are all these misconceptions that through this beautiful form of art, I have met people who are heterosexual, who are bisexual, who are transgender, who are, gender non-confirming, don't fall under the gender binaries, and from all ethnicities, all races, all around the world, celebrate drag as a performing art. So I think that, I realized very early in life that, I loved, makeup, and I loved the flamboyance and the exquisite nature of, getting into and looking the best version of myself. So whenever mom used to go to work, I used to open her wardrobes and, go through it and, see, wear a lovely dupatta and pretend like I'm Raveena Tandon and start dancing to Tip Tip Barsa Pani or, one of those beautiful songs. And Madhuri Dixit was there. And, these have been my inspirations. Rekha, while growing up, suddenly do you remember this movie, this famous Bollywood movie called Khoon Bhari Maang?
Oh, yeah.
In which she used to wear these beautiful, and Madam X. She was the first drag queen. Let's start there.
Yeah.
In my opinion, Rekha is a drag superstar. RuPaul and all have to fall in line, because Rekha, we have Rekha. If you have RuPaul, we have Rekha. So, and I think that, there were these powerful women that were doing powerful roles and women-centered roles in the 80s and the 90s that really sort of reinvented the whole idea of what films are, and what films are to women and strong female characters. And so that really encouraged me to be more in sync with the feminine side of my own being, and I believe that every person is an amalgamation of a synergy of male and female energy. And I think that through drag, I have the opportunity of expressing that. So I realized very early in life, because my parents used to, were never ever rigid when it came to our thoughts and the way we kind of wanted to express ourselves even as children. So I consider myself extremely lucky because at a very young age, I was allowed to, for fancy dress competitions or, mono acting and elocution and, all of these one act plays. I used to always end up being the, even in Julius Caesar, I used to always end up being the female character, or, in Macbeth, And we had all these amazing, you know, we used to study Shakespeare in school. So inevitably, I used to land up, I don't know, it's probably because, you know, they say that I have beautiful fingers and hands and, you know, I articulate very well. So, you know, the boys were boys, you know, like the more heterosexual boys that were like, you know, very, they had these very skewed opinions about masculinity, which were borderline toxic. And I kind of really, you know, was very comfortable with myself at a very young age. So right from that age, you know, I used to perform in, you know, in the, as a female character, and which is what sort of encouraged me to really dwell deeper and dig deeper into this whole form. Because, you know, back then we didn't have any references, pop culture references within India. So all my references were from the West. But at the same time, I realized that we have had such a rich cultural heritage. India has had such a rich cultural heritage. So I started reading on the subject. And then I realized that, you know, as RuPaul says, well, let me quote the queen. RuPaul says that, you know, everyone is born naked and the rest is drag. You know, like today you have chosen this beautiful pink top and this white cardigan, and I have chosen this wonderful neck piece and this beautiful handmade kurta. And that is our expression. Today we felt like wearing this, so we're going to wear it. That's our interpretation of, you know, what we want ourselves to look like today. And so I think that drag also allows each and every person to express themselves and not follow a certain norm or certain, you know, list of rules. You know, even within drag, Seema, you'll be very shocked that people are like, oh, you're a drag queen, but you should do, you know, you should paint your face like that, or you should wear your hair like this, or you should wear only lace front wigs. You should not have a beard when you're in drag. So there's all these, and I'm just like, am I missing something? Because I don't think you graduated from a drag university that I'm not aware of, you know? So I think they should calm down and take a seat, and take several seats at that. And if I had a mic, I would have dropped it now. So you can go to your next question.
No, beautifully explained. And I think a lot of misconceptions you cleared about drag, definitely. And you know what? Think about it. If any culture, our culture represents drag from centuries. All these theaters and plays, and not even, I'm not just talking about Ramlilas, the Maharashtrian plays, and so many. Men have dressed as women for years. Yes. And they have got awards, and they're the finest of actors. And in fact, I read somewhere that a lot of times over the years, they replaced women with women, women's role. And then when they did that, people like missed that. They missed the original actors who were acting as women. I mean,
yes.
They didn't have the term drag back then, but they kind of, and then they brought them back and.
Bang on. You know, back then we didn't know what to term this whole phenomenon of when, you know, someone whose gender is male at birth, who's assigned male at birth. Now, you know, we don't even dwell deeper into all of these, in all of these things, wherein, you know, in the more rural area, like India is majorly, you know, our population is rural. We have, of course, we have, you know, a diverse sort of audience. But I would just like to tell people that, you know, what do people in the more rural areas, in the smaller towns, in the tier 2 and 3 cities, not metro, non-metropolitan cities, now how do you go to them and explain to them this phenomenon? For them, it's just something that they've been seeing and they're doing, and they don't need to call it drag, right? We call it drag, we've named it drag, but that doesn't mean that, you know, just because a certain country or a certain group of people called this phenomenon or this art form drag, that means that they are the ones who founded it. I believe that India, as you said, even in our mythology, even in our cultural heritage, we've had the gods that have cross-dressed or taken the avatars of female goddesses. Oh, yeah. And actually procreated also. And you know, what is otherwise Ardhanarishwar or Shiv Shakti or, you know, all of these. And, you know, you see in the king's courts and queen's courts where, you know, they used to have these wonderful celebrations where men, as you said, used to perform as women. Because women back then were not, like, it came out of a mentality, because a lot of times you know, only tawaifs used to dance. Tawaifs, you know what tawaifs are.
Yes, yes.
So they used to dance, and the queens were not allowed to express themselves because they had to be, you know, in the periphery of royalty, and they were not allowed to like really interact with the male audience within their courts. So what used to happen is that the transgenders or the kinnars or you know, the royal eunuchs in some cases used to actually perform as you know, as a hyper effeminate being. And I think that that's beautiful. Why don't we cite these references? I never see anyone citing these references at all. It's not even like, okay, we missed it or something. We've completely neglected it. And it, you can neglect it till a certain extent, but after a point it's going to come forth and, you know, to the fore. So I think that it's extremely important that we are in tune with our cultural heritage, and as you rightly pointed out, it's been happening for centuries,
and it's still happening in rural
and areas. It's still happening.
Maybe not in the urban cities, but in the rural areas, it's normal. It's happening. It's accepted, and they have a system going on. And so, tell me a little bit about. I'm a little curious about your early years, your childhood. Tell us a little some fun stories as you did something and you stood out, and hats off to your parents.
I think hats off to my parents also. My parents have been such rock stars because, and you know what? The best thing was for a very long time, I used to always discuss this with my older brother, Karan. We used to always think that we were very poor. Because our parents didn't allow us to, you know, be arrogant or, you know, sort of let us believe that, you know, we are going to have everything easy in life. They wanted us to work for it, understand the value of it, understand where we're getting our next meal from, and that, you know, they have to had to work very hard to get where they are. And they, you know, we vicariously picked up and imbibed a lot from this process of their parenting. And I think that it's a very beautiful example for Indian parents that have an avalanche of absolute fallacies that they throw at children, saying that you can't be gay, it's impossible, we are not gay, how are you gay? Like, in terms of what they mean to say is that this is a phase, you'll come out of it. And I just like, I'm, of course, it's a little frustrating for me because I've had such understanding parents, but understand that this is your child first, and then he or she is gay, lesbian, transgender, whatever else. But first, that's your child. And then, you know, the fathers will be, especially a lot of times, the fathers will be, they'll blame the mother and say, and they say that, you know, you've only spoiled the child. Yeah, that's the reason why he's turned out like this.
Yeah.
And if anything, you should thank your damn wife, because most gay children that I have come across are overachievers. They excel supremely well in whatever they choose to do, because they've seen such a tough life right from the beginning that they are so much more accepting, they're so much more giving, they're so much more loving and empathetic and compassionate that you know, other children don't value as much of their parents or their journeys, because they get that, you know, convenient. It's like, it's basically like how there's white supremacy, and you know, they don't understand white privilege, some of them. It's like that. It's heterosexual privilege. They don't understand that, you know, they've got it so easy. Tomorrow, even if I have to step down to go and take like a out of something, or, you know, I have to just go and buy vegetables, I have to think 10 times as to what people, like, you know, it affects us. You know, we might not show it, even though I am, you know, where I am in my career right now. But sometimes it is, right? Like, you know, you're going into a public space, and then you don't know how people are going to look at you, because they look at you differently. They, you know, pass some remarks because they think they're entitled to, because you're not like them. So I think that is something we need to kind of work on as a society. Apart from that, coming to my parents are absolutely wonderful. Wonderful. I love the fact that they made us believe that we are not going to get anything easily, because that is what life is all about.
Awesome. All the parents should be totally listening to this. And for
I hope they do.
And you know, and I also know that they are actually activists, and they are playing role, not just being your parents, but also educating other parents and talking to them and bringing their concerns and letting their children be, you know, who they are. Having a life, if you didn't have parents to support, and I mean, coming out is a huge thing. But for you, it's not just coming out. It's so many other things that you've been able to do. I think that was, and that's the challenge for most, for you to make a career out of it and be an artist and be on your own and travel the world. So yeah, let's get to the highs of your life now. Mr. Gay World India. Sushant, guys, is an amazing singer. Indian Hindi song he will sing, and you will not know that how amazing he will be when he sings the Beyonce song. And
But you know, Seema, I am very bad at blowing my own trumpet. I just don't. I don't know when people. No, I'm very bad at it. You know, I don't like, you know, and sometimes I have to tell Nikki, my manager, that, you know, like, you know, you have to jot down things because I can't do it. And, you know, you have to tell the other person to introduce that part about me because I can't speak about, like, you know, myself. But yes, what I will say is that I had a very fun journey. And, you know, it's been a roller coaster, as they say. It's very cliched, but it's a roller coaster ride that I've had. And I just want to tell every brown queer child and teenager and young person, or you know, someone who's middle-aged or a senior citizen, it's a very beautiful process when you find your authentic self and embrace it to an extent where other people don't have a choice but to accept and embrace your orientation and your being and your comfort levels with yourself. Because once you're comfortable with yourself, it doesn't matter what the world says, you know. Everybody has an opinion, you know. And unfortunately, that is the reality. And but you're, as long as they're not paying your bills, it shouldn't affect you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, mere hum safar pyar ki raah par साथ चले हम मगर क्या खबर रास्ते में कहीं रह गए हम नशी तुम कहाँ मैं यहाँ तुम कहाँ मैं यहाँ जाने जा ढूंढती फिर रही हूँ तुम्हें रात दिन मैं यहाँ से वहाँ मुझको आवाज दो छिप गए हो सनम तुम कहाँ मैं यहाँ तुम कहाँ मैं यहाँ
yeah. I'm speechless.
Thanks. It's one of my favorite songs.
Would love it if you click on the like and subscribe button below. I bring positive stories from celebrities and philanthropists from around the world, and stay updated with all things fab on my FabLife 360 Instagram page. Also, if you are looking for something fun and inspiring to listen to, find my podcast FabLife 360 on iTunes, Spotify, Google Podcast, or wherever you get your podcast.